मॉर्निंग, नमस्ते। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस फीवर ऑफ अननोन ओरिजिन, और इन अदर वर्ड्स अर्लियर वी यूज टू कॉल इट पायरेक्सिया ऑफ अननोन ओरिजिन, PUO. सो व्हेन डू वी कॉल अ फीवर एज बीइंग ऑफ अननोन ओरिजिन? व्हेन फॉर द 2 weeks देर इज नो डायग्नोसिस फोर्थ कमिंग एंड द फीवर इज ऑल्सो नॉट सबसाइडिंग, then we call it a fever of unknown origin. Say for example, our malaria test, dengue fever test, NS1, chikungunya, or maybe scrub typhus, they should be positive right on the first day. But if no, then at least for 1 week we can observe for other viruses like enteroviruses, coxsackie viruses, etc. And if at the end of 1 week the fever does not subside, then there is time to think of typhoid fever. So by this time the patient would also have consumed some antibiotics, and probably even some of those antibiotics could be effective against salmonella as well. But if the fever is persisting, there is wisdom in either doing the typhoid IgM, IgG check, or if one has done on the first day, then there is time to repeat the tests. And if you find that there is a rising titer, then probably the diagnosis is that of typhoid. But even if this is not forthcoming, the fever is persisting, then there is time to think of tuberculosis at least by the 10th day. And when you get a chest X-ray done, you can easily rule out a pulmonary infiltration, a pleural effusion, a pericardial effusion, or something like a miliary tuberculosis. If the chest X-ray is also normal, then ultrasonic examination of the abdomen, that is ultrasonography, could probably reveal presence of lymph nodes, presence of ascites or hepatosplenomegaly, or presence of any other mass which is abnormal inside the abdomen. But if that also is normal, then the physician remains puzzled as to what actually is the cause of fever. And then at the end of 2 weeks, we start calling it as fever of unknown origin. So what is the key to diagnosis in such a case? Number one, we must repeat taking history, going into greater details of either joint pains, eye problems, ENT problems, tonsil problems, dental problems, any history of injections. Say for example, in one patient, iron injections given intramuscularly used to cause fever, but by 2 weeks even such fevers would have subsided. Then there is time to consider occult tuberculosis. And in India, the prevalence of tuberculosis is as much as 2.6 to 3.6% in different populations, and people are taking medicines, and those who are sputum positive and those who are urine positive, they are also spreading the infection. Now I am talking something new, which was actually discovered by Dr. V. M. Bapat of Pune in his paper published in the Journal of Association of Physicians of India way back in the year 2006. And he has pointed out that the urine collection done for 24 hours usually will show presence of acid-fast bacilli, not only in renal tuberculosis but also in any kind of tuberculosis anywhere in the body. For example, a patient with pulmonary tuberculosis having sputum AFB positive will also have urine 24 hours collection positive for AFB. And tuberculosis at such places where you just can't find out the presence of AFB there, for example, tubercular meningitis, the CSF will usually not yield AFB. In pars spine, you can't just go and aspirate through a needle the pus from there. In renal tuberculosis as well as the tuberculosis of lymph nodes in the abdomen, ascites, this technique of examining 24-hour urine collection for AFB is a very easy and reliable method of finding out whether the patient suffers from tuberculosis. And this paper was very important because of two things. Number one, it gives us a very simple, easy and reliable diagnostic test for tuberculosis. And number two, it also has public health importance, as well as it also throws some light on the host and agent interaction between the mycobacterium and the human host. I will like to explain it in greater detail. The health authorities think that only a sputum positive person is spreading the disease. Not so. Even a urine positive person is spreading the disease, and that includes every type of tuberculosis, pulmonary as well as extrapulmonary. And who knows, those who are not discharging AFB in their sputum but still have tuberculosis of the lungs, they may also have AFB present in their urine. And in India, since the discipline, the cleanliness, everything is not as up to standard, roadside urinals are not commonly found, and therefore sometimes people just piss at the roadside. And when the urine is settled down in soil, and the next day it will dry, and the mycobacteria resist drying, and when the soil becomes dry, it comes out as dust. And when the dust is inhaled by people, those people are infected with the mycobacterium. So this is a very important mechanism of spread of tuberculosis in India, and it will be wise to provide for public toilets at different places, and therefore nobody should be allowed to piss on the roadside. Then thirdly, what I want to point out is that it throws an important light on the agent-host relation between the mycobacterium and the human host, because what I think is that it is not purposeless that the AFB are thrown out in the urine. For example, the AFB are not just circulating in the blood so that they can be excreted through the glomeruli. They are not motile bacteria which will pass out and crawl through the glomerular filter. Then what happens is, actually, they are swallowed by the WBCs. For example, if a polymorph swallows an acid fast bacillus, soon it realizes that it cannot contain its growth and multiplication, and the mycobacterium can multiply inside the WBC very well. And therefore, thinking that I have to eliminate it from the body, the cell just jumps into the glomerular filtrate and commits suicide, because it knows that it will go out of the body when it jumps in the urine. Lekin ek Hindi mein kahawat hai na ki hum to dubenge sanam saath bhi tumhe bhi le dubenge. So the WBC, with its swallowed mycobacteria, it jumps into the urine, commits suicide, and it also paves the way for the AFB to go out of the body. And it is possible that out of this several cases which Dr. V. M. Bapat has studied, he has studied nearly 600 cases in which the pulmonary and extrapulmonary tuberculosis cases were involved, and it was shown that almost all of them discharged AFB in their urine. He also included some asymptomatic individuals, and to his surprise, some of the asymptomatic individuals, so-called as healthy individuals, they also turned out to be urine AFB positive. What will happen to such a person who is having no symptoms but his urine contains AFB? If you follow him up, when Dr. V.M. Bapat followed such a case, then he found out that after 4 months, the person started having pain in his dorsolumbar spine, and he was diagnosed as being a case of POTS spine. But it is possible that many others will eliminate the mycobacteria in their urine and thus will become free of the disease in due course of time. So it could be a very important defense mechanism for the body against mycobacterium tuberculosis. It should have been considered by immunologists and pathologists, and a larger study should have been planned. But rather than giving importance, this paper, which was a class 1 research paper, it was published in the column of correspondence. And although the correspondence column earned him a reward of first prize in the best correspondence in the year 2006, But I still feel that injustice has been done to this paper. Dr. V. M. Bapat's paper definitely deserved a better attention and inclusion in the research papers, and even probably a prize in the best research. I went to Pune in the year 2006-07. I met personally Dr. V. M. Bapat and congratulated him for this very important research. And since that time, 2006 to now 2020, I have been able to diagnose tuberculosis in at least about 850 patients through this method, that is, use of 24 hours urine for detection of acid fast bacilli. And our laboratory people say that when the AFB are there in the urine, they are plentiful. It is very easy to detect them. It doesn't require very high grade of skill. A simple sputum examination, just the way it shows you presence of acid fast bacilli, the sediment in the 24 hour urine also shows the presence of acid fast bacilli. And I call upon everyone of you to use this method for diagnosis of occult tuberculosis, because number one, those tests which are commonly employed are TB Gold and the Gene Expert. At times they also fail, because if there is a presence of AFB in the sputum, only then they will be able to detect. In extrapulmonary cases, they are not able to detect. Therefore, whenever you suspect that there is tuberculosis somewhere, this test is very important. Just collect the urine for 24 hours and send the whole sample to the laboratory. They will divide it into four centrifuge, and the centrifuge deposit they will examine by a simple Zeal-Nielsen stain, and the AFB are there to be seen. When I used to work in BHEL, my senior Dr. B.C. Raut, he used to say that sometimes the fever kills the patient. Yes, of course. If the fever persists and persists and persists and no diagnosis is forthcoming and the fever is not responding to any of our treatment, then the patient could die of fever. Yes, we have seen many people dying in the last about 40 years because of fever, undiagnosed fever. What happens? God only knows. But Dr. B.C. Raut used to say that no patient should be allowed to die unless he has tested the test of anti-tuberculosis drugs. And therefore, even if we cannot spot the diagnosis that it is a tuberculosis of this particular organ or that particular organ, or even if there is no proof of tuberculosis being there coming forth with, we have to use anti-tuberculosis drugs along with steroids, because the steroids will contain any of the autoimmune phenomena. Because what I am coming next to this topic is that there are so many fevers which occur due to autoimmune diseases, and now there is a new category added which we call as the auto-inflammatory disorders. And there are so many of them which will respond to steroid treatment. But if without anti-tubercular treatment the steroids are given, it is possible that if there are some mycobacteria hidden inside the body, they may flare up and they may multiply, and the number of bacteria could go exponentially high. And therefore it is wise, whenever the undiagnosed fever is there and if there is the slightest clue of tuberculosis anywhere in the body, then anti-tuberculosis treatment along with the steroids has to be given. Now coming to the autoimmune disorders, we have said that fever does occur in cases of systemic lupus erythematosus, in rheumatoid arthritis, in autoimmune hemolytic anemia and such other causes. But nowadays a separate category of auto-inflammatory disorders has been added, and if I have to quote from the recent edition of Harrison's Principles of Internal Medicine, it gives a list which goes somewhat like this: auto-inflammatory diseases in which fever is characteristic. Number one is adult and juvenile Still's disease, cryopyrin-associated periodic syndromes, CAPS, familial Mediterranean fever, hyper-IgD syndrome, Behçet syndrome, macrophage activation syndrome, normocomplimentemic urticarial vasculitis, antisynthetase myositis, pyogenic arthritis and pyoderma gangrenosum, Blau syndrome and gouty arthritis. Out of this whole list, probably I have diagnosed a few cases of gouty arthritis leading to fever, but that was easy. Looking at the joint swelling, uric acid levels, probably, and the response to treatment is very obvious, and therefore gouty arthritis will not give rise to a PUO because one would spot it. Secondly, these entities like familial Mediterranean fever, we don't encounter in India, and therefore I had no opportunity to diagnose any such case. Familial Mediterranean fever occurs in the Middle East, in the Arab countries, Turkey and so on. And we don't get familial Mediterranean fever here in India. Therefore, no opportunity to diagnose. Behçet syndrome, yes, we have suspected sometimes. It involves the joints and it also involves the oral mucosa. There are aphthous ulcers there. And such a case probably I had seen several years back, but I wasn't sure whether it did really have, where he did really have Behçet syndrome or something else. All of these others, they are very difficult to diagnose for us because we cannot rule out tuberculosis in most of the cases. Only recently, about 2 to 3 months back, I was struck with a fever which was not going anyway and which was I was not able to diagnose through the blood test. The fever continued for as many as about 15 to 20 days. There were no severe symptoms like an arthritis or cough, cold. Anyhow, when I went to Dr. Samarjeet Chaudhary for my diagnosis and treatment, he investigated me in greater details. And ultimately, by using all his might, he diagnosed me as being a case of adult onset Still's disease, and that was probably the first time that my attention was brought to this entity. And then I studied it a lot, and then I realized that in the last about 1 to 2 years, what I had suffered from several episodes of fever, they were not probably viral or enteric or whatever, and sometimes the fever used to respond to azithromycin, sometimes it used to come down even without azithromycin. I used to have some subcutaneous nodules and some nodules in the muscles. At times I thought they probably represent the muscle cysticercosis, and they responded to treatment with albendazole. At least once in the last 1 year, I had suffered from an episode of uveitis, for which I had to consult my ophthalmologist friend Dr. Siddhartha Trivedi, and he had given me steroids for about 5 to 7 days, and the uveitis had improved. At least once in the last 1 year, I had suffered from a severe attack of tinnitus, and for which I had to consult the ENT surgeon, Dr. Jaspreet Singh, and he also had given me steroids for a few days, and then the tinnitus had improved. But now when I look back and see, it appears that all these things were part of a bigger picture, and that bigger picture was adult onset Still's disease. And therefore, we must keep our eyes and ears open for the patient to narrate his history and to diagnose such a case if one has adult onset Still's disease. Although it is rare, it is found only in 0.16 patient per 1 lakh population, and therefore 16 in 1 crore. So it is quite rare, but even then, if you are able to diagnose with certainty and confidence, you are confident in giving steroids. The ultimate treatment of these disorders, which are autoimmune as well as autoinflammatory, there is a small difference. Autoimmune disorders are those which pertain to the acquired immunity. I mean, if you have anti-thyroid antibodies, it is very specific. They will destroy the thyroid gland and then they will settle down. Anti-thyroid antibodies will not disturb any other body part or organ. For example, if there are antibodies to the gastric parietal cell, they will destroy the gastric parietal cells and it will lead to achlorhydria and B12 deficiency. But apart from this, these antibodies cannot do anything bad to the other tissues of the body. They cannot damage any other tissues. But On the other hand, when we have an autoinflammatory disorder, these disorders pertain to the innate immunity, and there is abnormal production of cytokines. Sometimes, if there is an abnormal production of pyrogenic cytokines, for example, IL-1 and TNF, one can have a fever without a reason. The way you have read about syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion, there can be inappropriate secretion of IL-1 and TNF, and the result will be an outpouring of acute phase proteins like the CRP, like the ferritin, and of course there will be fever. The fever is not now resulting from any invading organism. There is none. You have investigated, because now our pathology laboratories are so well equipped, you can detect various types of antigens and antibodies, and at some better laboratories, you can even detect the levels of interleukins in the blood. You can detect IL-1, IL-6 and such other cytokines, and you can pinpoint as to which cytokine is being produced abnormally and in abnormally high quantities. And now there are specific drugs. We call them as biologicals. They are costly agents, they are injectable agents, but they are there, and in case of need, one can use them. I advise that you refer to few pages of the Harrison's Principles of Internal Medicine, and you will come to know about several biologicals like etanercept, like infliximab, which is a monoclonal antibody against TNF, and now we have so many monoclonal antibodies against various cytokines, and now this biological treatment is at its peak. It is highlighted, it is the most important focus of research all these days. So regarding pyrexia of unknown origin, what we can do at our level is that we can do our efforts best to find out if it has any treatable cause. And the most important treatable cause for us in India is tuberculosis. And I told you that for the diagnosis of tuberculosis, the 24-hour urine collection and observing it for AFB is a very important, very useful, inexpensive and reliable test. When giving steroids, one should pay attention that the steroid should be given for as short a period as possible, and keeping in mind their adverse effects. They can raise the blood pressure, they can raise the blood sugar, they can produce hyperacidity, and of course, in the longer run, they produce osteoporosis. All the measures should be taken to prevent, or if these adverse events happen, to treat them. The blood pressure needs to be controlled, the blood sugar needs to be controlled, and as soon as possible, the steroid regimen should be shifted to alternate days. For example, if one is taking 10 mg of prednisolone daily, it is wiser to take 20 mg of prednisolone on alternate days, because the day when you don't give the steroid, the internal ACTH secretion resumes, and therefore there is no suppression of the pituitary in the longer run. I have seen that giving alternate day steroids suppresses the autoimmune and autoinflammatory diseases, and the therapy could be successful for several months to years. So this much for today regarding the pyrexia of unknown origin. Even despite all our measures, there will be some patients who will definitely die due to fever of unknown origin, not having been diagnosed and not being controlled by any measures that we apply. Sorry for that. Presently, we'll stop here. In the next lectures, we will discuss about pain in general, and then in the next lecture, we will discuss about the relief of pain through opioid analgesics. Thank you. And just a request, those of you who have not subscribed to my channel, please do so. And also please press the bell icon so that you will get a notification whenever I upload a new video. Thank you again.